Praise the Lord, church.
Praise the Lord.
It's good to see you on this live on this Sunday. Isaiah chapter 40 verse 31, it says, those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength.
Yes.
They will soar on wings like eagles. Amen. They will run and not grow weary.
Amen.
They will walk and not be faint.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Let's praise God for some time. Let's worship His name. Everybody clap your hands and sing.
Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord.
Isaiah chapter 41, verse 10, it says, Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Let's worship God for some time.
You are my strength when I am weak. You are the treasure that I see. You are my all. Or to give up what be a fool. You are my all in all.
Sing it, taking my sin.
Taking my sin, my cross, my shame. Rising again, can I bless your name? You are my all in all. When I fall down, you pick me up. When I am crying, my cup, you're my only.
Every time I sing, Jesus,
Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your Christ, who lives in me. Christ is risen, Jesus, you are Lord.
We give thanks to your name, Lord. We give entire thing into your name, Jesus. You take complete control, oh Father. There's nothing we can do out of our strength, Lord. We need you in every situation of our life. We give thanks and we give glory, oh Father. We give everything into your mighty hands. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Amen.
Praise the Lord. God bless you. It's really a pleasure to meet all of you on this last Sunday of May 2021. I'd really like to take this opportunity to thank God for giving me this opportunity to exhort you this morning. Book of Acts, chapter 10, verses 1 and 2 reads, "There was a certain man in Caesarea called Cornelius, a centurion of the band called the Italian Band, a devout man and one that feared God with all his house, which gave much alms to the people and prayed to God always." When I read this portion, you know, this portion of Acts 10 is a very important chapter for all of us who follow Christ. It is in this chapter that God revealed to Peter that the gospel was there for all of us, the Gentiles. And it is in this chapter Luke is writing and recording is, he's talking about this person, Cornelius, a centurion. There are two lessons I could understand over here from this chapter and these verses. Number one, we see over here, Cornelius was a man who feared God, who sought God, and who gave much alms to the poor and the needy. For all of us who are joining in today, we open our hearts and we give. But the message over here is, what is there on verse 4? In the latter part it says, God remembers every act of kindness. And it is for this unsaved man who did not know the gospel, God made a record of his heart and his giving of alms and saved not only him, but his whole family. So for all of you who are joining in today, who are seeking God, and who are having a kind heart of helping, God is making a note of all your givings. And he has a day marked for you to be saved. But for all of us who are here, who know the Lord, who have been giving, who follow the Lord every day in our lives, who are saved, what does this verse have in significance to us? Do we also have to give so that we may also receive salvation? No, we have received salvation by his grace. He has saved us. But over here, it says, when you give, God makes a note. And what we have to remember is what Jesus said in the book of Luke. He says, love your neighbor as you love yourself. So in these days, when there is so much of challenges and problems, I urge all of you, brothers and sisters, to open your hearts, love your neighbors, look at all the people who are suffering and help them out. And here is one opportunity where you can also sow in the church and help those people who are needy. And it is when you are sowing your seed with the love you have for your neighbors, for the love you have for God, he is going to make a note of it and going to bless you abundantly when the time comes. So all of you who are joining us, who are yet to know the Lord, remember, God is keeping a note of what you are giving. And all of us who follow God, remember, love your neighbor as you love yourself, and he will bless you. Let's take our offerings and pray. Precious and Holy Father, we praise and thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for your wonderful words, O Master. Thank you, Lord, for telling us once again that you remember every act of what we do, Lord. Your word says, O Master, that you will honor us. We trust in you, Lord. We give not because we are expecting that honor, O Father, but we give because we love you, Lord. We love you and we love all our neighbors. And use our offerings, O Master, to help us to make that harvest, to gather into your kingdom, O Lord. so that more and more would be there when you come and gather us, O Father. We love you, Lord. We bless you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The announcements for the day. Promise service will be held on the 1st of June at 6 a.m. on Tuesday. This will be through YouTube and Facebook. Women's intercessory prayer will be held on 12/6, which is a Saturday, 5 p.m. to 6 p.m. We invite all the women to participate and be blessed. This meeting will also be through Zoom. Lunch and Learn Fellowship will be held on 13 June from 12:15 p.m. onwards. We have an exciting topic of identifying your temperament. Kindly register for joining on the given number below, and you will also receive the test to know yourself and your spouse through this, which will be held on Zoom. Build Professional Fellowship will be held on 26/2021, which is again a Sunday on 12:15 p.m. through Zoom. Life groups are happening week on week from Monday to Friday on Zoom. For more information, kindly call any of the numbers given on the screen. Sunday Tamil service will be held at 7 a.m. and 9 p.m. You can join through online on YouTube and Facebook. And every Sunday, the English service will be held at 10 a.m. You can join on YouTube and Facebook. Thank you and God bless you.
Everyone, welcome to the third part of our series, The Seven Signs of the End Times. For the past 2 weeks, we've been looking at, beginning with Israel, the incredible covenant that God made with Abraham, which became the eternal covenant, and how we are seeing, even till today, the fulfillment of the promises God made all those many years ago. It's been an incredible study. And last week, we looked at Ezekiel 38 and 39. The impending war that the Bible prophesies about, and how we see the skies looming and everything being falling into place for a potential Ezekiel 38 and 39 fulfillment. So in case you've missed those two messages, I'd encourage you to go back and watch them, because they'll be truly a foundation for what we're talking today, be a blessing for you as well. You know, 25% of the Bible is filled with prophecies. Now, out of that, almost 75% of those prophecies have to do with the end times. God has a lot to say about these days that we're living in. What's incredible is the prophets who received these prophecies and these revelations, even though they lived in a time which was so many thousands of years ago, they wrote down things they did not understand or even comprehend. And today, as Bible scholars are studying the scriptures, are beginning to see so many of the things that the prophets prophesied about, those things existing today. Today, especially, we're going to look at knowledge and technology as our third sign. And we're going to look at how incredible it is that the Bible, so many thousands of years ago, talked about some of the technology that we have today, which are all in place, again, indicating to us that the coming of our Lord Jesus is very imminent. We're so glad to have our senior pastor with us once again. He's been doing an excellent Bible study with us for the last 2 weeks. And today as well, we're going to be privileged to have him share with us God's truth. So, Dad, welcome. And I'm glad to have you. What do you have to say about knowledge and technology?
It's a great joy to join you again today about the end time teaching in the prophetic book of Daniel, chapter 12, verse 4. But you, Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book until the time of the end. Many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall increase. In the times of Daniel, God said to Daniel, in the end time, knowledge shall increase. God told Daniel to shut up the prophetical book because Daniel could not understand all the visions he had about the end time. Daniel is a wonderful end time prophetical book. Many times when we read through Daniel, we ourselves don't understand what it means. And even Daniel could not understand many of the dreams or prophecies. In Daniel chapter 7, God gives him a glimpse into the future events about the four different kingdoms that will come in the time of Daniel and after the time of Daniel. Daniel lived in the period of Babylonian kingdom. So after Babylonian kingdom, Daniel was wondering what will happen. So God gave him the vision about the Medo-Persian Empire. And after the Medo-Persian Empire, God gave him the vision about the Grecian Empire, how Alexander the Great will rule for a short time and how his dynasty will be divided into four different kingdoms and so on. Then God gave him the dream about the Roman Empire. And again, at the end of the Roman Empire, what will happen? God gave him a vision about a beast coming up from the sea with 10 horns and 10 crowns. And out of that 10 horns, a little horn coming. So Daniel couldn't understand, what are these signs? What is God telling about? Then God showed him about the Almighty God sitting upon the heavenly throne and ruling and reigning and giving the kingdom to the Son of Man. So Daniel was wondering, what does all these things mean? Again, in Daniel chapter 9, God gives him a correct timeline when these prophetic events will happen. About 70 weeks of Daniel, a clear-cut prophecy in the timeline of the end-time events. In Daniel chapter 11, God again tells Daniel about all the wars that will happen in the end time. So Daniel could not understand. He was asking the angel, "Angel, please explain." But the angel tells Daniel, "Daniel, seal up the book. You go and take rest. You don't worry about all these things because it will take a long time for these events to be fulfilled." So Daniel obeyed God and sealed the book. But in Revelation chapter 22, verse 10, God told John when he wrote the Revelation in the island of Patmos in the year 90, God said, "Don't seal the book because these things are going to come to pass quickly." To Daniel, it was sealed. But in Revelation, the seal was opened. And especially in Revelation chapter 6, we see the seals were being opened. We are living in the time when the seals are being opened and the end time prophetical words are being fulfilled. So one of the end time prophetical prophecies that Daniel prophesied is that the knowledge shall increase. People will travel here and there and will research everything. So how is the knowledge increasing? In three ways, the knowledge will increase at the end time. The first way how the knowledge increases is that the biblical prophetical knowledge will increase in the end time. See, the church went through different periods. In the first century, there was the great revival. In the fourth century, when Constantine became a Christian, the whole Christianity, the whole nations became Christian nations. But then there was a dark age. The truths of Bible was concealed. But in 1517, Martin Luther brought the truth of Reformation. Zwingli and many others came and the Bible was translated in all the languages. Then came the Wesleyan movement and the Anabaptist movement, baptism and the sanctification movement. In 1900, the end time began when the Holy Spirit was poured on all the flesh. In Azusa Street, the revival started. In 1950s, the revival of healing started. In 1960, the charismatic movement started. In 1970, the missions movement started. In 1990, house group church movement started. In 2000, God began to reveal to the church about the gifts of the Holy Spirit, and especially the body ministry, the apostolic prophetic ministry was once again revealed and released. At the time that we are living in, God is revealing the end time truth. Now people are looking into the scriptures and seeing the fulfillment of the prophetic words in front of their own eyes. So there is a great desire that is stirred up in every heart to look into the prophetic events and compare the biblical prophecy of Daniel and Revelation and to see how these things are being fulfilled. So certainly there is an increase in the prophetical knowledge of the end time teaching. The second increase in the knowledge is the general knowledge that people have. See, nowadays we have Google and YouTube. So people say, if you don't know, Google it up. So in our days, we used to ask our grandfather or father, mother, what's this, how to do? Yeah. Even now, if you don't know how to do a baptism, Google how to do, give a baptism or Google this and that. So how to conduct a marriage. Google is the answer for modern day's generation. Till 1900, man's knowledge, it took about almost 100 years to double up. So it took 100 years for man's knowledge to double up. Till 1948, till the Second World War, man's knowledge doubled up every 25th year. Mm. But now they say man's knowledge is doubling up every 13 months.
Wow!
And now since the computers are, internet computer has come, they say that man's knowledge will be doubled up every 12 hours.
Wow.
Every 12 hour, man's knowledge will be doubled up. Mm. That's the time period we are living in when there is internet, computer, Google, YouTube. Man can go and find out everything. Mm.
So what's fascinating from what you're saying is there is an incredible increase of knowledge about the end times, the biblical end times. Now, I remember as a kid, one of the things that my granddad, your dad, would get really excited about is to go and start a conversation with him about the end times. You know, if you talked about anything to, you know, about the return of Jesus, his face would light up and he would get all animated and he would start telling me, I was just a kid, all about what Jesus was going to come back. And I can almost imagine if granddad was alive today, he'd be running up to the roof.
That's
and
right.
He will be shouting, Jesus is coming
Amen.
Back. Jesus is coming back. Because so many things that we see in Scripture, we're beginning to see the fulfillment of it in front of our very own eyes. When you're talking about knowledge increasing, general knowledge increasing, you could certainly see increase in knowledge about medicine. Man knows so much more about medicine today than he has ever known.
Mm.
And I would say there's an increase in knowledge about agriculture. We have about 7.8 billion people on this planet. And somehow we know how to produce food for those 7.8 billion people. There's an increase in knowledge about how to plant, when to plant, all of these things about agriculture. And not just that, there's an increased knowledge about the planet Earth, universe. There's such an incredible increase that has taken place in knowledge about general things. I remember as a kid, you know, we used to have the encyclopedia. You had bought an encyclopedia that would have on a shelf where, you know, you'd have A to Z of all the things that we could learn about. And today, you just need Wikipedia. And you could look up Wikipedia for any answers you want. You don't need to. The information that is available at your fingertips is endless, which is scary when you think about it.
Man's knowledge is increasing at such a fast speed. And man knows everything nowadays. He's able to go to the moon. Man is now researching into the planet and the space and the stars and trying to send the space satellite and so on. So man's knowledge is increasing at a greater speed than we ever imagined. The third increase in the knowledge is about yourself. Government knows all about you more than you know about yourself.
Wow.
Take, for example, in India, the Aadhaar card.
Mm.
The Aadhaar card is a unique identification number, a 12-digital number that government has given, used as a biometric system to identify who you are. So when you register your name with the Aadhaar card. It's linked with your income tax and so on. So government knows all about you. Imagine 8 billion people's all the data are stored up with the government. This is nothing but a preparation for the end time ruler. When the Antichrist comes, he will know all the details about you, your bank account, everything. Recently, I heard a funny story when a man wanted to order something from a KFC. He wanted to pay cash, but the machine was able to tell him, hey, you didn't take any cash from your bank, so you can't pay with cash. If you have any other cash, that is illegal money. You have so much account in your bank and so much you spend. This is the money you have balanced. So the computer was able to tell him what he spent, how much he received, everything. So that's the technology that man has today. Nothing is hidden from the computer. Computer stores up everything.
I think another avenue where people know about you is social media.
Mm.
Facebook and Instagram. People literally volunteer information about themselves today. You know, back 10 years, 15 years ago, if you were trying to locate a long-lost friend, you would need to either have their phone number or where they lived and maybe even a phone directory to actually go through those yellow pages to locate them. Not anymore. You just get online, type their name, and you pretty much are able to locate anyone on planet, you know, if they're on Facebook, pretty quickly. And then not only that, you get to know a lot about them, where they live, what they do for a living, and what they had for breakfast. You know, people post pictures about everything they're doing these days. There's so much information available about ourselves, knowledge about ourselves that's available for others to know as well. And not only that, CCTV is another interesting thing. You know, CCTV, I read recently, today, as of 2021, there are 1 billion cameras that are all around the world recording what's happening, that people are doing. And out of the 1 billion cameras, more than half of those cameras are in China. So if you're a citizen in China, you know, there's pretty much nowhere you can go where you are not watched by an eye in the sky. And I would say this is the most watched world that we have ever lived in. And the prediction is, you know, China is one of the highest users of CCTV, followed by US and UK. But the prediction is, in the years to come, India, Brazil, Indonesia would overtake the UK in having more number of CCTV cameras installed across, which means these are the infrastructure that are being put into place for when the rule and the reign of the Antichrist comes into place, for him to be able to control and exercise authority to persecute or locate people who don't have the mark of the beast. You know, all of that infrastructure is available today. There's literally nowhere you can hide at this point in time.
That's why in Tamil Nadu, everywhere they are installing CCTV camera so that anybody robs anything, immediately the police is able to find him and catch him and arrest him and put him in the jail. So it's a marvelous modern technology of CCTV camera. Because of that, thefts are decreasing. So many good things are happening. Mm. Another prophetic word of Daniel is, in Tamil Bible it says that in the end time, people will travel here and there and there will be an increase in research.
Mm.
So there will be an increase in the research knowledge and the technical things. So today, when we look at the world, we see how people are researching into different things. And especially in our times, in my father's time, to get a phone was a big thing. So we had to wait for 3 to 5 years to get a phone. It was such a big thing. And when we got the phone, we got excited. It was like just a big phone with the old type of grandma's phone.
Yeah.
So when they invented a radio, they said, this is the end of the invention. Man has invented the last thing. But now we have come across telephone, television, telegram, telefax, and so on. In those days when we want to send a mail to somebody, it took 3 weeks for a letter to go and come. Then the telefax came, so we were able to send letters immediately. After telefax, the email came, computers came. Now a smartphone has come, which has made life so comfortable and easy. Every day, man is innovating new technologies, which is making life very easy and very sophisticated for the modern day man.
I think your generation is a very unique generation, and I think to a part of my generation as well, because you have literally lived through the time when you had the telegram, moving from telegram to telephone, from fax machine to internet, and then to be able to, you know, have mobile technology and all of that. In Daniel chapter 12, verse 4, another phrase that Daniel uses in regards, which I think that is applicable to technology, is, in the last days, many will run to and fro. I think many Bible scholars, you know, are able to presume that it would imply to transportation. And I think if all the technological advancement, transportation is seen one of the most incredible leaps in our time as well. Back in the 1600s, if you were to travel from North America to Europe, it would have taken you about 2 months, you know, via ship to be able to travel across the two continents. And that too, given the weather, you know, it could have taken longer as well. And then you had the 1900s, they invented or they manufactured the Queen Mary II, which was reputed to do the same journey in 7 days, which was a big thing. There was big, it was a huge achievement of man in regards to transportation. Here we are today, you know, we're able to make that exact same journey in 7 hours. So you're looking at a span of just a few hundred years from 2 months to 7 hours. You know, Elon Musk, you know, who is considered, you know, a great inventor of our time, some of the things that he is proposing for the future is incredible. You know, one of the plans that he has is for rocket travel to be available for the common man.
Wow.
So he's saying that, you know, not rocket travel, not just to outer space, but rocket travel within the globe, within the world. So you would take off in a rocket and you would be able to travel from New York to Shanghai in 39 minutes.
Wow.
So his proposal is travel anywhere in the world in under an hour. You know, he's talking about a hyperloop, a tunnel, you know, which is, again, super fast travel that will take place. And all of these predictions that he's talking about in bringing about travel as something that is available to the common man. And I think back in the 70s and 80s, traveling outside of the country was a huge deal. You know, I remember when you used to travel abroad, we pretty much would have a huge group of people coming to the airport to send you off. And especially if you're traveling abroad, it was a celebration thing when you left or when you came back. Not today. You know, people travel, you know, out of the country as a normal thing. You know, of course, during the pandemic, it's been restricted. But in normal times, international travel has been available to the common man. And you could see what Daniel said in Daniel 12:4 actually happening today. Many are traveling to and fro today.
It's amazing how travel has increased in this modern day. And when you see the flights, I mean, pre-pandemic days, all the flights were fully booked and people were traveling. And even ordinary people, common people were traveling everywhere. In our days, if somebody goes abroad, he will be very much honored and say, hey, foreign returned man, he will have a special name and he will have a special treat. But nowadays, everybody is traveling. I remember in those days when you were children, we used to go to KGF in our old van. And the roads were so bad, it took about almost 10 hours just to travel about 250 kilometers. But now, the roads are so nice, travel is made so easy. Even in Gurgaon, I heard that they are trying to invent some cars that will go very fast and reach from one place to the other place, like underground train system, tubular cars they are inventing. So modern day travel is on the increase. This invention of this modern day technology is for the spread of the gospel.
Mm.
That's why today they are inventing so many things. So we as children of God should use all these modern inventions for the spreading of the good news of the gospel. Because Jesus said in Matthew chapter 24 verse 14, this gospel shall be preached unto the ends of the earth, then will the end come. So this gospel of Jesus has to be preached to every ethnic group. They say in India alone, there are 2,500 odd ethnic groups in India. Among these ethnic groups, still 2,200 plus groups are not yet reached with the gospel. That's the greatest challenge for every Christian, every believer to share the gospel with the neighbor, with the unreached people. My mother had a great passion. She will go to all the tribal villages and preach the gospel and cast out the demons. Many of those tribal people used to say, this is the first time we are hearing about Jesus. Still, there are so many people who have not heard the gospel. That's why God has given these modern inventions. In 1990s, India opened up the gospel in the television. So we were able to go into the television network and start preaching the gospel through television. Many thousands and many millions of the people who would not have had an opportunity to hear the gospel had an opportunity to hear about Jesus. So the television and all the other modern equipments that they are inventing, we need to take them, take these weapons and use them for the spread of the kingdom. My dear brother, my dear sister, our great commission is to tell someone that Jesus came into this world to save them and to give them eternal life.
I think one of the other advancements in technology that we see evident in our day is the wireless internet technology. There's a passage of scripture in the book of Revelation that has got great application in regards to wireless technology. And this is what the Bible says in Revelation chapter 11, verses 7 onwards. The Bible says, when they complete their testimonies, talking about the two witnesses, the beast that comes up out of the bottomless pit will declare war against them. And he will conquer them and kill them. And their bodies will lie in the main street of Jerusalem, the city that is figuratively called Sodom and Egypt, the city where their Lord was crucified. And for 3.5 days, all peoples, tribes, languages, and nations will stare at their bodies. No one will be allowed to bury them. I think this passage of scripture, we don't need to speculate anymore as to how this could come to pass. Because, you know, I think even in the 1950s and 60s, when they invented the satellites, you know, technology with beaming television signals across the world, everyone was excited because they said, oh, you're able to transmit, instantly whatever is happening. But today we see a greater, you know, positioning of technology that enables this passage of scripture to become a reality.
When Apostle John wrote this prophetic word, he could not understand because 2,000 years ago, there was no television, no radio, nothing there. But he clearly saw in the vision and how when these two witnesses were killed by Antichrist, the whole world could see these dead bodies. So John would have been wondering, how can this happen? Maybe in the newspaper it will come, but everybody cannot see at the same time. But Bible clearly says every tribe, every language, every nation saw these two bodies lying in Jerusalem for 3.5 days and they are being raised up. So, but now, in our days, this is no more a fantasy. Now we see the world news happening every day as soon as it happens immediately in our television. So this prophecy is being fulfilled in our own eyes. We can see when these things happen, when Antichrist kills them, we will see how they are killed, how they are thrown in the roadside, and we will watch them for 3.5 days. The people of the world will celebrate because these two witnesses were persecuting Antichrist and his followers.
In 2007, when Steve Jobs introduced the iPhone to the world, he literally revolutionized the mobile technology. Mm. You know, until then, your phone, pretty much all that it could be used for was for calling people, text message, or maybe if you had a BlackBerry, maybe email. But when the iPhone was introduced to the world, there's so much more capabilities that was given into the hand of an individual person. And what's incredible is today, the technology that is in the iPhone is so much more far superior than all the technology that was available when they launched the Apollo 11 rocket. So when they launched the Apollo 11 rocket, they had computers as big as cars that were positioned in different rooms. That was what was the computing power that enabled them to launch the rocket. So today, the iPhone or any phone that you hold in your hand has got more computing power than the computers that launched Apollo 11. Think about it. The simple technology that's available to us, whether it be even a calculator, some of the technology that is available today is so much far superior to what was available even 30, 40 years. The advancement of technology has been so exponential that there's no resemblance of what technology was 20 years ago to what it is available today. You know, a lot of us, we were hearing a lot about 5G last year. I don't know if you got some of those forwards where people, you know, were thinking that 5G was the reason why we had COVID. You know, I don't know if that's true or not. But what 5G technology is basically is it's the fifth generation of wireless technology. And everything is ready for the rolling out of 5G technology right now. AT&T, one of the biggest mobile operators in the U.S., they're pretty much on the verge of making 5G available. And the reason 5G is so important to the technological advancement is 5G offers internet without lag. So you have people like Elon Musk who's been talking about self-driving cars, automatic drive or self-driving cars, which requires this internet wireless technology that is available to them without lag. The reason why, you know, even though self-driving cars are pretty much, you know, available in some states in the U.S., they're still needing this breakthrough technology that 5G is available to give them. Mm. And once 5G is made available, they're able to bring out so many more new innovations in regards to e-commerce and other things, which will use this internet without lag. It's going to be super fast internet, wireless technology that does not have any delay or lag, so instant communication of information. So that brings, you know, today, you know, they're already in some states in the United States of America, they have pizza delivery by self-driving robotic cars. So if you ordered a Domino's pizza, they're delivering it to you via a self-driving car. So much advancement is available. When the Bible talked about these two witnesses lying in the whole world, all tribes, all nations seeing them lying there, you know, today we have the technology for it. You know, especially in the last 2 years with the pandemic, pretty much everyone has gotten used to watching things on YouTube. And one of the features that YouTube has is not just to watch videos, but to make videos. So all you need is a smartphone, you can stream live from wherever you are. A common man with no need for any big cumbersome television equipment or technology, you can stream from whatever location you are and pretty much the whole world can see what you are streaming as well. That's exactly what John was talking about. You know, the whole world watching in one instant moment what was happening in Jerusalem as well.
It's very interesting to see the advancement of technology and how the advancement of technology is fulfilling the prophetical words of God. Certainly we can say we are living in the end time and the world is preparing for the one world government, for the one world religion, for the one world ruler. All this advancement in technology is for the preparation of the next kingdom that's going to come. Again, in Revelation chapter 13, verse 17, Apostle John sees this in this vision. He says, and no one could buy or sell anything without that mark, which was either the name of the beast or the number representing his name. So in Revelation chapter 13, Apostle John talks about the beast. Beast is the Antichrist. So when the Antichrist comes, he will make an image and he will give the power to the image to speak and to monitor and to kill the people who will not take that mark of the beast in their right hand or in their forehead. What an amazing thing that we are witnessing in our days. Nowadays, because of the pandemic, wherever you go, in the shops or in the places, they want to check your forehead or check your hand. So that's a preparation for the coming of the Antichrist. It says everyone has to have a mark on the forehead or on the right hand. So that is called the chip technology is now coming. What is the chip technology? They want to insert a chip into your right hand or a forehead, which will give all the information about you. So when Antichrist comes, everybody will have a chip so that when they go to the market, they want to buy or sell, they need to show that chip then it will give all the details about them. That's a marvelous technology that people are inventing in these days about the chip. And this prophecy is now being fulfilled in front of our own eyes, preparing the world for the soon coming of our Lord and the rule of the Antichrist.
Elon Musk is a founder of a company called Neuralink. And the goal of that company is to infuse technology with the human body.
Mm.
So we're coming to a point where we're saying, well, the mobile phone is big and clunky and heavy. I don't like carrying it everywhere. I might lose it. What if the mobile phone was interfaced within my body? And that's what the goal is to bring the interfacing of technology and merging it with the biology. So man and technology become one. You know, we're beginning to, you don't need to carry a device. You have the device in you through a chip and other things as well. It's fascinating. Some of the things that they're preparing, and they're already on the verge of releasing these technologies. It's not something that they're researching about.
Wow.
This has come to such advanced levels of development in our day that they're about ready to launch these things as well. A couple of years ago, in 2017, there was a company in the United States where they put a chip in all their employees, and this was done voluntarily. All their employees volunteered to have a chip implanted in their hand so that when they walked into work, they could easily have their attendance done, doors would open for them, and all the things that they needed for going to work would already be in their chip. It's already there.
Hmm.
You know, it's not something that they're planning for or hoping for.
Wow.
Even this pandemic that we've experienced, and like you said, has conditioned us further to be able to be ready to accept this mark that is impending that the Bible talks about. You know, maybe a few years ago, there was a lot of resistance to, you know, having a chip inserted into the body because people would say, it's my body. I don't want anyone messing with it. I don't want a chip inserted. But today, you know, with the vaccines rolling out, and I was reading in the papers today in the state of Oregon in America, they're rolling out a vaccine passport and making it mandatory in the sense if you are vaccinated, when you enter a restaurant or enter a building, you're supposed to show proof of your vaccination so that you can walk without your mask. Otherwise, you need to have a mask. So it's just a matter of time where they're going to go from there to say, well, why are you carrying this, you know, proof of vaccination? You know, why don't you just have it, you know, digitally put on your phone or, you know, just put it on a chip. You just show it and you walk in. And I'm not saying that the vaccine is the mark of the beast by no means. But what I'm saying is the infrastructure, the foundation for what is needed for what the Bible talks about, the mark of the beast, is already clearly evident in our world today. And everything that needs it to be ready is already ready. And that's what's fascinating when we look around today.
When we hear all these things, we know that we are at the end time and so terrifying that the days are so close for the rule of the Antichrist. So we hear about the bioman and the chips. That was kind of many years. They were thinking how this can happen.
Yeah.
But now it's becoming a possibility. I hear that in Sweden, many people have already have the biochip in their hand. So the bioman they are trying to invent so that man can live long and so on. So many new technologies are coming up in these days. I also heard about the robotic machines. So the robots are now functioning in hospitals, in restaurants, and even for the war, they are preparing for this robot warfare man. So they are finding out new technologies how to use the robot and the machines for the end time, which is very terrifying. So another advancement in the end time is cashless society. So our government, present central government, is advancing or advertising more and more about the digital currency. They don't want to use our cash flow anymore. So they want to bring the whole of India in the digital currency. Mostly an Indian village person doesn't know how to use a credit card or any of this digital currency. But now they are teaching everyone through different PayPal or the Google Pay or different apps that they have to use the digital currency. This is preparing for the rule of the Antichrist. So when Antichrist comes, the whole world will be one currency, and there will be digital currency, and no one will be using cash money. That's why the Bible says, without the mark of the beast, you cannot buy or sell. Look at Amazon. Most of the world has gone into the e-commerce. About 90% of the people nowadays, because of the lockup, buy things or sell things through e-commerce. And the days to come, it will become common for everyone to buy or sell. And when you go to Amazon, you'll have to use your password. So of the password, unless you use your password, you cannot buy or sell. So the same will apply. Unless you have the mark of the beast, you have to show the mark, then only Amazon will allow you to buy or sell. So it's becoming possible in our days to see this prophetic word being fulfilled.
And I think even in the last 2 years, we've seen a exponential increase in the usage of e-commerce by people as well. And I think Amazon posted a 84% increase in their profits for last year. $386 billion they made just because of the pandemic and more people opting to buy through Amazon. And this is just another infrastructure. When the Bible says no one will be able to buy or sell, it's just like you said, the more everything becomes centralized on one platform, the more there is the possibility of control in a larger scale. Another fascinating thing that I came across was the social scoring system that is already at play in China. You know, as I was telling you, China has more than 500 million CCTV cameras that is already in their country. And one of the things they do is they monitor their citizens. And they have a scoring for their citizen behavior. So if you have a citizen who is obedient, who's following the law, they get a high scoring. And if you're a citizen who is, you know, flouting the laws, you're not following the law, you get a low scoring. And there is a penalty for those who are scored low. Meaning if you are a low scoring citizen, you do not have the privilege to travel. For example, if you get online and because they're monitoring your movements, you won't be able to book a train ticket. You won't be able to fly. You won't be allowed a seat on your local bus. So in that way, they're already controlling, you know, who gets to travel just by using the CCTV cameras. And I kid you not, this is the foundation upon which, you know, the rule of the Antichrist will take place, where they'll be able to monitor every single person on this planet. And the infrastructure is being developed and it's increasing day by day, which means there's no one who could hide from the tyranny that is to come by the Antichrist as well. The persecution of those who do not follow Jesus, the Antichrist will use this kind of technology where they will surveil to be able to easily identify who are the people who have the mark, who don't have the mark. All of this is already here.
So no one can hide from Antichrist. So the best way to escape the Antichrist is to get ready for the coming of
that's
the law.
That's right, yes.
If you want to go through the 7-year period of persecution and troubles in the time of Antichrist, live jolly the way that you want. But if you want to escape all these tortures, persecutions that are going to come and all of God's judgment going to come upon the earth, we need to get ready and be prepared for the rapture, for the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Another advancement that we see in today's world is the advancement in the medical technology. Till 1950, the average age of the human being was only 50 years. But today, the average age of human being is raised up to 72 years. Man likes to live for long. He doesn't like to die. So that's why there's a lot of innovations out as to how to live long. Today in the world, we see people living till 80 years, 90 years. So ordinarily, many people live to a great age and they live comfortably because the medical science has made it possible for a man to live till a long age. See, today because of the medical inventions, the heart rate diseases has come down by 40%. Today, they have invented the stem technology by which they are able to treat a lot of sicknesses. And again, for cancer, for HIV and for many of other sicknesses, they are finding new therapies to heal people from the various sicknesses. Now the robotic machines are helping the operations and they are able to be successful in getting these operations done through the robotic machines. And today, through the MIR scan and so on, they are even able to read the mind of man. So advanced is the medical technology. People are able to live long. That's man's desire to be immortal. And the science is helping man towards that.
It's like you said, you know, man's desire to live immortal. They want to live forever. Now, that's exactly what the Bible says. God has placed eternity in our hearts. There's a great desire for us because God did make us for eternal, as eternal beings as well. So there is a desire. When you talk about, you know, the advancement in medicine, one key area that there's huge advancement is in the DNA modification technology in medicine. They call it the CRISPR, where they're able to treat disease by altering your DNA as well. We don't have time to go into it. You know, we're going to put up a link for you or Google it. You can go find out how it's becoming very, very popular, this ability to treat disease by altering DNA. Another fascinating thing that I came across was something called a spider goat, where they take the DNA from a spider, because spiders weave these webs that have great tensile. Mm. So they want the same ability to make ropes that have the same strength. So they take the DNA from the spider, merge it with a goat, and from the milk of the goat, they're able to take out the same strength for making strong strands. It's fascinating what's available. Recently, I came across another news where in Florida, they genetically modified mosquitoes and grew them in a laboratory and then released them. And what these mosquitoes do is, and when they mate with the female mosquitoes, the offspring of the female mosquitoes die immediately. Mm. All of this is by manipulating DNA. And this is scary because there is a set order that God has placed for mankind, rules that we are to follow in regards to His creation. But when man begins to meddle with things that God has set as rules and set up as laws, there's definitely going to be a lot of consequences. And you can see this happening in the field of medicine and the advancement that, you know, like you said, robotics is one part of it. Biohuman is one part of it. You can see such incredible advancement to the point that you're beginning to get scared, like saying, this is something that I don't think God is going to be pleased about. You know, some of the things we read in Revelation where it's half human and half animal, there's technology available today that definitely is pointing towards such a future that man will be able to do as well.
It's really scary to see some of the modern day inventions, how man is meddling up with the God's creation, and we don't know what the world is up to. So it's all very scary to think about. The next advancement is the nuclear capacity of the world. Man is trying to increase the nuclear capacity, and this world is getting ready to be destroyed by fire. A lot of Bible verses say like that. In Jeremiah chapter 49, verse 23, says, Damascus has become feeble, and all her people turn to flee. Fear, anguish, and pain have gripped her as they grip a woman in labor. And again, Luke's Gospel chapter 21, verse 36 says, men's hearts failing them from fear and the expectation of those things which are coming on earth, for the powers of the heavens will be shaken. Jesus saying, man's heart will fail. That means man will get heart attack by seeing different things that are happening. And again, Revelation chapter 6, 14 to 17, I believe these verses talks about the nuclear kind of weapons being used in the end time, and people are afraid of being affected by the nuclear radiation and running into the mountains and asking the mountains and the caves to hide them from the wrath of God. Revelation 8, verse 7 talks about the first trumpet. When that first trumpet of the angel is being blown, then what are the judgments that are going to come? It says, hail and fire followed, mingled with blood, and they were thrown to the earth. And a third of the trees were burned up, and all green grass was burned up. In Zechariah chapter 14, verse 12, talks about when the end time, even when people are standing, their flesh will be rotten, their eyes will rotten, and the whole body will be perished because of the radiation that comes through. So it all talks about the nuclear weapons of the end time. In the last World War, America used atomic bombs to destroy two great big cities of Japan. So many people died, but they thought they were the two big atom bombs. But they say in the last 70 years, 2,500 nuclear warheads have been tested in this world. So the world is getting ready for a nuclear war. 9 nations have stored up about 15,000 nuclear weapons. Anytime a war happens, they just touch a button, the whole world could perish by the nuclear radiation, the nuclear weapons. About 1,800 nuclear weapons are already set in force to destroy different targets in different countries. So that's the time we are living in.
If it was not for the grace of God, man would destroy himself. I think God is holding back man's foolishness, and until the appointed time comes for him to begin the work of what he has promised that he will do as well. Now, for those of you who are listening to us today, hearing about all these things that are falling into place as a fulfillment of what we see in Revelation, like I said when we began today, it's fascinating to see an ancient book, the Bible, has such relevance today in so many of the prophetic words that we can see evident in fulfillment around us as well. What does a child of God do when we see the imminent return of Jesus Christ? How do we respond to it? Now, do you run up to the roof of your home, pitch a tent, and look up skyward and sit waiting for Jesus to come back? Now, what do you do? You know, the Bible says in 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 6 to 13 onwards, we're not supposed to be idle. You know, as Pastor was saying today, there's a great need for the preaching of the gospel, for sharing Jesus Christ with people. I think the more we see the day approaching, the more we see the things falling into place that is showing us the imminent return of Jesus, the more passionate we need to become in sharing the good news of Jesus Christ. And obviously, to prepare our life the way we live, to live pleasing to Christ, and to live a life that is worthy of the call that God has placed upon our life. And the last 2 weeks, I've been also sharing, you know, the Bible talks about this salvation available to all of humanity. God is no respecter of person. He is not in any way biased. God has made salvation through his Son, Jesus Christ, available to every single human being on planet Earth. And we are living in the day of grace. And soon the days of grace are going to end. Then we enter into the days of God's judgment. And I beseech you today, if you're listening to our program and you've never experienced the salvation of Jesus Christ, if you've never accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, today, right now, is the time to do it. Don't wait another moment, because we are living in the last moments of man's history. And anyone who calls upon the name of Jesus Christ receives forgiveness and salvation, the Bible promises. Today, right now, wherever you are, you could just lift up your hand and say, Jesus, I need you. Forgive my sins. Become my Lord and Savior. And Jesus is faithful to forgive your sins and also prepare you for the kingdom that is to come. This is what's so exciting. As a child of God, when we see all of these things happening around us, we do not panic. We're not given to fear. We experience the opposite, which is great peace and expectation, where we begin to say, come, Lord Jesus, we're ready for you. And I want to pray with those of you who are listening to us. You know, a challenge for you to be more vocal about sharing the love of Christ, and also for those who do not know Jesus, an opportunity to say yes to the greatest gift that God has ever offered mankind, the gift of salvation. Would you pray with me? Would you bow your heads wherever you are? I want to lead us in prayer for a moment. Heavenly Father, I pray for those who have been listening to us today, the signs of the end times. We looked at how you fulfilled so many promises to Israel and how you fulfilled every single thing that you said you will do for the end days in concerning of Israel. Lord, we looked at all the things falling into place for Ezekiel 38, 39. And today we looked at so much of the technology that we see that the book of Revelation and the book of Daniel talks about actually in place today. Lord, we're excited when we see all these things. We are yearning for your return. I pray that you prepare us, your body, for the return of Jesus Christ. Make us righteous, holy through the precious blood of Jesus Christ. I pray for those who may be listening to us today who have not yet experienced the gift of salvation today as they call upon the name of Jesus, the name that is more powerful than any other name under heaven and earth. I pray that today they will experience salvation, forgiveness of sin, and they will experience and receive the gift of salvation today in their life. Lord, I pray for us, your children, that there will be an increase in the desire to share the good news of Jesus Christ with as many people as possible, to share with them how much Jesus loves them and the incredible plan and the purpose that you have for our life as well. We thank you for the opportunity you've given us to study your word. I pray that you will continue to speak to every single person who's listening to this program today, that they will prepare themselves for the return of Jesus Christ. We give you glory, honor, and praise. In the precious name of Jesus, we pray. Amen, 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 amen. May the Lord richly bless you. We're so glad that you're able to join us. Continue joining us for the next few weeks as we continue studying the seven signs that we see that are indicating that we are truly living in the end times. Share this message with as many people as you can so they can hear about this and also prepare for the return of Jesus Christ. Maranatha, God bless you and be with you today. Amen.